Do I fight for fame? Do I do documentaries for fame? Well, I'm not going to lie to you. There's certainly a side to me that loves being in front of the camera. Yeah, so what? If I'm good on camera and I get fame by helping raise money for my kids, and if someone thinks that I'm some narcissistic asshole doing this, you know, fuck them. Because again, this is about my kids and this is about my cause, and I don't really give a shit what anyone thinks. I just want to help raise money for my kids, raise awareness, you know, and knock the shit out of this disease someday. And I want my kids to live the best life that they can live. You know what? I love being a dad. I think that it's probably what I'm best at. I think I was put on this earth to be a parent. I think I'm a great parent. I think that I'm a vulnerable parent. I think I show many sides to me. You know, I think you have to be a special kind of a parent when you have disabled children.
Being married to Mark is difficult at times because he does have a great sadness when it comes to the boys.
We all know my dad sometimes has a little bit of an ego, but I think his heart is in the right place and he just really wants to advocate and everyone. He just wants everyone to know Troy and Andrew's spirits and how amazing they are, so.
But I try not to think, you know, in the beginning stages when my sons were diagnosed at a young age, I thought every day about losing them. You know, I was told when they were diagnosed at birth that they were going to be cured by the time they were 5 years old. You know, now they're 22 years old, and although there's still no cure, there's been major medical advancement and major mountains that have been moved, but it's a ticking clock. They're 22 years old. The life expectancy for a boy with Duchenne's, you know, when my sons were born, was 12 to 15 years old. You know, it's strange. It's this crazy, sick, fucked up, twisted disease, you know? I mean, they lack a protein in their body called dystrophin, and you know, they have deterioration of muscles and their muscles atrophy.
I'm Dr. Bernard Canaan. I'm a physician who looks after the pulmonary aspects, which means the aspects that affects their lungs. Duchenne's muscular dystrophy is a weakness of muscles that affects boys. A muscle weakness that usually starts in 3 or 4 years of age and usually affects the muscles of walking and the muscles of using your hands, and then ultimately progresses to a weakness of the muscles used for breathing and the muscle of your heart. So it's a long-term gradual decline in motor and muscle function.
Illness has pretty much dictated my whole life. They were diagnosed at birth because most kids that have Duchenne's are diagnosed at 5, 6 years old. Families don't know that there's a disease. They find out when the child starts walking and starts tripping and things just don't seem the same.
Duchenne's is passed on because it's a mutation in a gene, and it's in this thing called an X chromosome. And ladies have 2 X chromosomes and boys have only 1 X chromosome. So if they have one bad gene, there's nothing else to compensate it, so it's called X-linked. And it is one of the more common X-linked diseases, so it's passed from the mom who's carrying it on to the boys.
as a young adult, you know, I knew there was a history of disease in my ex-wife's family. I was young. I didn't know much about it. There was no internet. But could have I done more research? I question and second my guess myself that every day and beat myself for that every day. Then all of a sudden, we create these boys that have this disease, and now for the last 23 years, I've been a fucking maniac trying to cure this disease. You know, so finding that out at a young age, you know, at first it sunk me into depression. It broke up my marriage to the kid's mother. It just devastated me. And, you know, lucky I had some good support behind me. One of my best friends, Frank, helped kind of pull me out of the dregs.
My name is Frank Brack, and I've known Mark Schepeta since sixth grade. He and I were riding the pine in Little League going way back. Mark, as a young person, was a lot more fun-loving than he is now. He was really happy-go-lucky, and he and I just joked around the whole time as young people. He's definitely changed and become a lot more serious in his old age, I guess you'd say. After the boys got diagnosed, it was definite change in him, and it was sad to see, you know? Knowing the pain that's inside that is always kind of, like, just under the surface.
Yeah, life before kids and life after kids is, it's completely different, you know? I think also life means a lot more with kids, because everything you do is no longer for yourself.
And then I just started to, you know, wake up and be motivated. You feel hopeless when you're a parent and when you have a child that has this disease. You feel like you need to do something, whether it's just hold a can on the side of the road and collect quarters or go work at a telephone or something. You feel extremely hopeless and you feel like you need to do something.
You know, I think obviously what Mark is doing is very important, and it's beautiful what he is providing for his boys and for other families and you know, their children. And
so I guess I could, you know, just raise money in simpler forms, but to me, I go all out. It's balls to the wall at every time. You know, there's no sitting back and just asking someone for a fucking handout. I don't want that. I'm gonna give you an entertainment value, and I'm gonna put my body on the line, because if you're gonna take the time and donate to my kids and my cause, everyone knows Troy and Andrew. They're the twins. They're like little celebrities. And I see it with all these parents that have children that are diagnosed with this disease. They you know, they have benefits and they have fundraisers. I've just used my crazy, wacky personality to blow it out of proportion and make these things like freaking extravaganzas.
I can't even hear myself talking. My ears are...
You're talking. They can hear you.
Am I talking? But no, this is all about the Wheelchair Strong Foundation. When we started this less than a year ago, we've actually been in existence. And we've already done a major comedy show. We're doing this amazing event tonight with Aquanet. You know, our mission at Wheelchair Strong Foundation is to entertain. I just don't like asking for handouts. I like to give an entertainment value, whether it's comedy, whether it's rock, whatever it is. But we're here to entertain, and the inspiration of those two boys back there. So make sure you get up there.
My name's Craig Pina. I'm the chairman of the board of the Wheelchair Strong Foundation. And I've known Mark for about 20 years. We actually met when we worked out together at the gym.
So when my dad wanted to start the foundation, I got really excited about it because it's something I'm passionate about. In my career, I'm a development assistant, so I work in philanthropy, and it's all familiar to me. So to work for a foundation that's near and dear to my heart just makes it that much more important. And it just makes raising money for a cause even more powerful.
One of my reasons for setting up the Wheelchair Strong Foundation was to raise money, to advocate, but to also get the twins involved and put a social aspect into their life. They are involved in every event. They hang out at every event with all their friends in wheelchairs. It, you know, it gives them something to look forward to and other kids to look forward to. And, you know, in the majority of our money goes back to adaptive sports and vehicles, and we just gave out $10,000 in grant money.
I think Mark may come across desperate at times, but he does it in a very nonchalant way. Like I said, as far as wanting people to come out and laugh, you know, and raise awareness for the cause at the same time, he wants to provide enjoyment and entertainment for everyone who's supporting the cause, as well as knowledge.
And I don't do traditional shit, as everyone knows. Everyone that knows me, everyone that knows Mark Chapetta knows that I don't go out and, you know, have bingo tournaments or golf tournaments. That I go out and either get the shit kicked out of me in a cage fight, or, you know, hire a professional wrestler, or bring in some of the top comics around the world to entertain.
The Comedy for Cause is an amazing event that Mark has worked so hard with his talented team to put together. His wonderful twins, and it's, you know, I'm really honored to be part of it, and to do a show in such a big a venue and to have such a great crowd, it's really a testament to him.
So the Wheelchair Strong Foundation is, you know, our charity, and it's, you know, we are geared towards raising funds for Duchenne's Muscular Dystrophy, raising awareness, and then we turn around and we give our money to, you know, amazing organizations like my big sister, the Jet Foundation, who's here.
I've realized through, I guess, the last 10 years or so, or even more so recently, that, you know, everyone copes with stress in different ways. And for me, I would train and I would fight to raise money for my kids. You know, in the beginning when Troy and Andrew were diagnosed, you know, I tried going to, you know, a therapist, you know, a shrink, a psychotherapist, but I didn't find it helpful because they didn't really understand what I was going through. I need to do certain things, I guess, to be able to sleep at night and be able to have the strength to, you know, take care of them, have the strength to advocate for them. It's my job to bring them to every doctor's appointment, make sure they have the best doctors in the world, make sure they're taking their medicine, make sure that I wipe their nose when they have a cold, make sure I keep them healthy so I can keep them safe. So I don't lose them. Yeah, so fuck yeah, I'm scared. Who the fuck wouldn't be scared? I have twin sons that are 22 years old. And, you know, I don't want to have to bury my sons. I should go first. All right, here we are at Max Training Center. It's been about, 9-10 years since I've been here. Mike Varner is the owner of the school, my old coach. Place looks the same, hasn't changed. Plate hasn't changed at all. I even wore my Wheelchair Strong shirt tonight. I don't know if I'm ready for this, to be honest with you. You know, I'm a little stiff, I'm a little sore. It's my first night back, and I'm kind of excited to surprise Mike and get back into the grind here. There's only one place I'm going to go, and it's Max Training Center. And I remember I got to take my shoes off. Got to respect the dojo. Just don't zoom in on my toenails. That could be my secret weapon.
Man.
Oh,
yeah.
Good to see you, man. School looks awesome. You look skinny.
Hey, dying.
And I see you're still keeping the place clean. Looks great.
But listen, tell me, what brings you to these doors after 10 years, though? No, I'm serious.
Man, I'm considering getting back in the cage, so I'm gonna get back in here and fight, and you're the man to do it, so.
You know? Dude, you're gonna fight again?
I'm gonna try.
But what Mark's doing is he's initiating this fight. It's him, you know, doing something amazing for a cause. You know, he's done it now ever since I've known Mark, which is prior to the first fight. So am I against it? No, I'm for it. I mean, there's people out there fighting far more dangerous causes. I'm not gonna say better causes. I mean, this is an amazing cause, just as good as any other out there. But yeah, I mean, I think it's worth Mark putting himself at some risk to bring awareness, to bring change to the situation.
Years old. Horrible. Kid's no older than 25. Jiu-jitsu stud. I jumped back in the first night.
I can barely go 5 minutes. I feel like I'm gonna puke, and I'm not gonna be able to walk tomorrow. I feel horrible.
I honestly am not okay with Mark getting back into a ring. I think it's ridiculous, honestly, at almost 50 years old. I think he, you know, has to take care of the boys. I think, you know, sometimes it's he forgets and makes it a little bit about himself, being the center of attention, and doesn't think of the fact that he could get hurt.
So Mark recently contacted me and told me 12 years later, he's looking to try to get back in the cage, get back into that fight shape. You know, I'm gonna try to talk to Mark a little bit more. I don't think it's in his best interest. I feel the fight game's changed a lot since back in the day when we fought, and then he fought, you know, a year or so later. He got a big win out in the Brockton Stadium, which is awesome. The game has changed.
Listen, I have the utmost respect of Mark for everything that he does, you know, for his boys and for the Comedy for a Cause. But getting in the cage, he's out of his mind. Not even because he's 50, because he's still in great shape. And I'm sure he'll do really well. But, I mean, that's a sport where, you know, you certainly don't want to come in second.
As Mark's friend for so long, I always support him in everything he does. I'm always at all of his events. But getting in the ring, it's pretty insane. And he's never really been quite normal.
He's crazy. He's old. He's an old man. He's going to get hurt.
I think Mark is crazy, but I think if there's any worthy reason, you know, he's doing it for Duchenne's.
You know, when I decided to fight many years ago for, you know, for my kids and for my cause, you know, it started off as a challenge. And then the challenge turned into something that I needed to continue to do, you know, to raise money, to raise awareness, but also, you know, for myself and for my own inner strength and conviction.
This time around, you know, when he said that this is what he wants to do, I try and be the supportive wife, but I definitely give my opinion in thinking that it's not a good idea for him.
I think he's a little crazy. I think it's definitely a coping mechanism for him to get back in there and get after it. As far as it being irresponsible, you know, I think that's a stretch. I think he's doing all right. He's one of the toughest people I know, so he'll be all right.
One of the stumbling blocks that I'm having with this whole journey trying to get back in the cage at my age is, you know, it's been 10 years since I last fought, and when I last fought, all they really required was just blood work and just get in there and bang. Now they require all these, the commission requires all these tests and exams, so apparently from what I'm reading and the paperwork I've got, I have to have brain scans done. My heart has to be checked out, MRIs, CAT scans, retina exams. I mean, it's crazy. So I think what they're basically saying is at my age, you should not get back in there and do this.
Drop off, put your gloves aside, put your shin pads on. Relax, you'll feel a special release. So you don't have to rip on that head, guys. That's bad. Now pop this over the head, really. Bang, bang, under. Hip slow. Hip it on his body. There you go. Right? And then what? Inside control the can. Right? I have to work back so I can at least work this, and then I have to work back.
Thanks, man.
Yep.
Ow, that hurts almost as much as that punch. That's it, I made it. Made it through a class.
You want my weight?
Yes, please.
Oh, God, this is the tough part. Taking my sweatshirt off because I want of an accurate weight.
Sure.
This is like a pound.
The sneakers,
right?
If you want to, as
just
well.
Like for my wrestling days, yeah. Think light.
I got about 3 pounds of clothes on. So
okay. 195, that's not right.
Okay.
No way that's right. I need to get down to like 169, 170, so I got a ways to go.
Do you feel sick at all today?
No, I feel great today.
Fever, chills, anything like that?
No.
Do you mind if I get your blood pressure?
Not at all.
This is just kind of your heart rate.
Yeah.
Mark is a very healthy individual. I've known Mark a long time, and I know he takes care of his body. I know he's in the gym every day. But that's a lot different than getting your bell rung. There's just no question about it. You can be in peak physical condition, but anything could happen in there. That's really what I'm worried about.
I need to get cleared. And getting cleared to fight at my age is a freaking major obstacle.
I mean, right off the bat, this has to be completed by a licensed physician, which I am not. So, I essentially can't clear you, even a basic physical. I cannot clear you. I mean, this would be $30,000. Right. Without batting an eye. I mean, you get a specialist exam, they bill $500 for an office visit.
Right.
And that's just to sign off on an EKG, you know?
Yeah.
Given the fact that we are a charity and we are a nonprofit, and what I'm doing in theory is sort of crazy and outrageous, that I don't know if my board's going to allow the release of the funds. The other possibility would be to get these exams donated and try to go down that avenue. But right now it looks like we have a mild stumbling block that hopefully I can get through. So.
And I'm just going to press on you, Billy. My hands are cold. Yeah. Sorry. No pain when I'm pushing?
No.
Or is it just my frigid hands?
Your hands are cold.
Okay, you can sit up. The biggest obstacle is going to get these specialists, neurologist who doesn't know you from a hole in the wall, ophthalmologist who doesn't know you, to sign off. I mean, essentially, it is liability, you know? And it's all about kind of passing the buck. And they're not going to want to do that. I think that's probably going to be the biggest obstacle.
I can't get cleared. If the referrals don't go through, if I can't get it donated, then my last resort is to try to pull a favor with the commission and see if they'll sign a waiver to allow me to fight. But I honestly can't see them doing that, only because it's just a major liability.
Well, I can imagine the concern that the state commission might have with a guy 50 years old getting in the ring and fighting guys in their 20s. They're trying to cross their T's and dot all their I's and make sure that everything's on the up and up. They want to be healthy, but yet it's not a sport that is really conducive for a 50-year-old.
The one thing that has been and is consistent with Mark is his desire to compete, his desire to fight for what he believes in, and the one thing that I could sense and feel in all those punches was exactly that, his determination to show himself, to show his family that he could get back in there and do this again and fight for this cause.
I think me training, going to the gym in the morning, going to the MMA school or the grappling school, I think it just gives me like Janice always tells me, Janice says, Mark, you're grouchy. Get your ass over to the school and go roll with some of the guys or do something, because you always come back sore, but you come back sore with a smile. There's just something on about it. There's a camaraderie, there's a brotherhood, there's something that makes me feel young when I'm doing it. At almost 50 years old, it makes me feel young. It makes me feel invincible and makes me feel like I'm, you know, on top of the world. And sometimes when you need to take care of kids that have a disease like this, you need to feel invincible.
Recovery is going to be one of the biggest problems. Also, before I was a nurse practitioner, I had a degree in exercise physiology. I'm familiar with training, athletes, marathon runners. And as you get older, you get a decrease in what we call organ reserve, backup power, backup strength for your heart, your lungs, your kidneys. At 49, the training becomes more difficult. The recovery becomes more difficult. You, especially when you think about neurological, the fluid around your brain dries up a little bit. You don't have all that cushion. So, you know, do I think it's a great idea for a 49-year-old man to get in the ring and fight? Who knows? Who knows who you're going to be fighting? No, I don't think it's a great idea. But can I blame him? No. I mean, especially as a father of twins, who am I to say? If they told me, you know, get in a ring for your kids, where are the gloves?
I don't know. What I always remember about Troy and Andrew is how, you know, how happy they are and how welcoming they are and how wonderful they've always been with me. I saw they were driving for a little bit there I felt like I had the little big brother nerves, but I think they did well. I was proud of them, and you know, I think they are quite special dudes, and you know, they're good dudes.
Drive great. I'd say Anders a little bit better driver than Troy, only because he's driving right now and my life is in his hands. Yeah, we live down here in Carver in the country, so it's a lot of windy roads, so they kind of drive a little bit in the city and then they drive a little bit in the country, so it's a nice balance for them to drive.
Is it this one yet? Well, the van, it's set up for us. So like the seatbelts will be hooked up so we don't have to unbuckle them. We just drive right into them and then just, we hook into them. Oh. And the door, we have the key to open our door. So everything's all, the van was made to be set up for us. So he doesn't have to be there all the time to help us. Sometimes Troy yells at me for doing things wrong. It's also not a quiet drive because we like to listen to our music while we drive, so our radio is usually up loud. We like listening to rap, but my dad doesn't like rap music, so when we're in the car with him, we have to listen to his foreign music.
10 lessons in, I'm sitting in my office, and one of the Brockton cops called me because he knows me, and he said, you better get down to CVS on Main Street because your kid was just in a wreck. So, I mean, talk about, you know, your heart dropping. So, you know, it's amazing that they were able to, especially Troy, to jump back on the horse, you know, after getting in a car accident, and he wasn't going to surrender. And as scared as I was, and as much as I wanted to say, you know what, fuck it, hang it up, I don't want him driving anymore, I couldn't show him that. I had to continue to show him that, you know, you got to get back on, you fall down, you got to get back up, you got to continue to do it.
Yeah, I was, it was probably, what, 10 days into learning how to drive, and I got distracted. Everybody gets distracted at some point and gets to an accident at some point. But it was a bad accident. I had to get rushed to the hospital and everything, but it didn't make me not want to drive ever again. I just went right back out there 2 weeks later and drove.
That bad? I'm with you.
Camera. No, I'm not. Don't wait. My father, he drives, he never gives up, so when he wants to do something, he has to do it. So same thing with me. When I want to do something, I'll do it.
And wheelchair soccer is just, it's new within the last 10 years, and it's just something that's give these kids something to have that competitive spirit and competitive edge. So you're going to get an opportunity to see some of it tonight, and these kids whipping these balls around. Trust me, an able-bodied person getting in a wheelchair, it's crazy. It's impossible. You saw me trying to drive these things earlier. So,
now, I've been playing against Troy and Andrew for a few years now, but I remember the first time that I saw Troy and Andrew, they were at the national tournament in Minnesota playing in the lowest division of U.S. power soccer. But over the years, they've gotten better. Now that I live here in New England and I play against them on a regular basis, I see how much they've improved.
Let me just put it this way. These guys were so competitive that when we first stopped playing, I had to separate them because they used to actually fight with each other. As they mature, they can actually be able to calm down during the games, but these guys are really, really competitive, extremely competitive.
One thing that has always been there has been the competitive drive. I mean, they're just such fierce competitors.
Troy is a forward. It's one of our best scorers. He can control the entire game on his own. Andrew stays in the back. He's our goalie defender. And every time we're struggling for goals, I push him up on midfield. They're really good, probably one of the two best players in the country. And I'm not exaggerating about that.
This whole soccer experience, everyone here is family. All the parents, we travel together all over the country. Our team, they were actually national champions.
It's being able to start from the bottom, see them improve year after year, and then succeed to the point that they actually are national champions, as you know.
You see the energy in the twins that you do in Mark.
This is our fifth tournament we've been at in the last 5 years, and you know, power soccer is such a big deal in Troy and Andrew's life and in my life, and it just brings community together, brings a lot of the families together, and there's over, I'd say, you know, 60 wheelchair athletes here today. And, you know, everyone's just happy and cheering, and no one's disabled here today. Everyone's, you know, everyone's just an athlete, and everyone's competing, and everyone's on the same level. So, you know, I think adaptive sports brings that out mostly in these athletes that, you know, they're just regular people, just here having fun with their families, competing, and the spirit here is amazing. So I'm blessed to have this in my life. Really been a stressful week for me. So right now, as I'm being interviewed, there's a lot of pressure and a lot of tension in my body, because it's been a real trying, stressful week. So, you know, then having Troy and Andrew here this weekend and it being Father's Day, there's only so much room. So when you're coping with something like a disease like Duchenne's that's very taxing on your body, there's not much room for error for other things. So I was telling my wife that I need to get my ass back over to the school, and I need to get a good role. I need to hit the mitts. I need to do something. It's what I do for myself. You know, there's other people that cope with things in different ways when it comes to stress and dealing. But I only have so much room mentally and emotionally within this body. Things, I know I'm always going to click on all cylinders, but when they're not clicking on all cylinders, it's tough for me. It's tough for me, and the only thing I can do is try to get that frustration out in other ways, and hopefully it passes. I've considered trying to hold a class for parents that have disabled children, you know, to try to teach them how to cope, because you really need to be in top physical and mental shape in order to take care not only physically a disabled child, times two for me, but mentally deal with it. And those are the moments we have when I'm picking them up the wrong way, or they're pissed at me for this or that, or because of who they are as people, they tend to be a little bit overly worried. You know, they don't have control of themselves, so they get a little bit of a cold, they obsess over it. So I have to constantly you know, field those questions and try to make them feel good. And it, you know, so training just makes me feel, I think, mentally and physically strong enough to be able to cope with what I have in my life. When I don't train, I don't cope with it so well. It's pretty simple as that, you know. But life is so crazy and so busy, I don't find myself training enough, so it's a constant roller coaster, you know. So I wish I could try, and I try my best to do it as consistently as I can, but that's probably why I'm just a mess all the time. My cardio's fucking awesome right now, dude. Like, I, you know, I'm rolling. I'm doing 5-minute rounds on the mat, rolling. I just started Lozon's, man, and I've trained with Joe Lozon before, but this new school he's got over in the Brockton Easton line, and the way he runs it, it's just phenomenal. Joe Lozon's son, Joey, has childhood cancer, has cancer. So, and I believe he's in remission right now, so Joe's been doing a lot for the Jimmy Fund.
So my son Joey was born almost 5 years ago now, and it was like, it's like one of those bittersweet things, because you're so happy to be a parent, you're so happy, you love him so much, like instantly, but he came out and he was not breathing very well, you know. So like, they have the NICU team there, and like, I just like, I felt like I was just like shrinking, because like, I'm used to being able to, you know, influence and control things that go on in my life, and, you know, be able to help things and whatever. And then in that situation, there's nothing I can do. I'm literally sitting there completely helpless, unable to do anything. And it was a roller coaster, you know. It went from like, oh, he's having a little trouble breathing, to, oh, he's got cancer, to, oh, you know what I mean, like dealing with all that stuff, to, you know, doing great now. You know, I've known Mark for a long time. He has one of the toughest jobs, because it's so tough to be a parent on its own. And then on top of this, he's, you know, he's dealing with all this stuff with his kids. And he's constantly trying to do stuff to raise awareness. And it's a big undertaking. You know, he takes a lot. He carries a lot of weight with all that. So Mark's been training on and off. It's been a roller coaster. You know, like, life gets in the way. You got to focus on different things. You have to prioritize. But in the last 6 months, he's been in. He's been consistent. I think he's happier. Maybe not so happy when we have guys crushing him a little bit. But overall, he seems much happier. Seems like he's in a much better place. He's lost a lot of weight. He just seems much, much happier overall. It's kind of nice having that little bit of break from all your outside stuff and kind of focusing on just stuff that's going on right here, right now. Jiu-Jitsu is awesome for stress, because you're constantly forced to manage stress. You're in a bad spot. You get someone bigger than you with dropping all their weight in your face, or crushing you, or choking you, or doing something, or you just, maybe someone's smaller than you, you just don't want to lose. You know, it's just like, it can be very, very stressful, but it's great because all of your outside stresses, they go away. You're not thinking about it at all. You forget about everything that's going outside, and you're so focused on what's going on in the moment. Number one thing is just enjoy the time while you have it. You've kind of been on borrowed time for a while now, and it's just, you know, kids are still seeing him fight. They're still seeing him strive and try to, you know, make improvements and raise awareness and all sorts of stuff. And you have to think that they're still around because of that, because they just see like that fighting spirit, and they just keep on pushing.
Yeah, so I got a call from producers from 60 Days In. It's an A&E television show, and they asked me to participate on this TV show. They just wanted me for 30 days, but they were real pushy, and they were offering an amount of money that I really couldn't pass up at the time. And, you know, but they needed some quick answers, which is very difficult for me, because I have a very fast-moving, fast-paced life. You know, a lot of pieces to the puzzle that are kind of constantly moving around. So, you know, I discussed it with Janice, and I discussed it with the twins. And initially I told them, no, I'm not doing the show. I have no interest in doing this show. But they kind of pressured me, and they kind of pestered me. They had watched some video of me, footage of me on YouTube from some other projects I've done, other projects involving my kids. They liked my backstory. So I decided that I was going to do it reluctantly. And whenever I know that it's not the right thing and I go ahead with it, it's always going to turn out disastrous. And it was probably one of the most disastrous eye-awakening, eye-opening things that I've ever dealt with
in my life.
So, you know, so what basically happened was I eventually decided to go on the TV show. I had to get all my affairs in order with my business, and I had to also get all my affairs in order with, you know, Troy and Andrew and the children and my responsibilities to them, which are a lot. But, you know, they're always supportive of me. And at the time, I was trying to convince myself it would be the best thing to do for Wheelchair Strong Foundation, for Duchenne's, for my kids. You know, and the money certainly doesn't hurt. So it was a lot packed into almost about 2.5 weeks. You know, so then I take off, I go to Arizona, and then it's 3 days of interrogation and emotional interrogation and interviews and pulling on the heartstrings and, you know, and asking me if I could handle going to jail. Are you tough enough to go to jail? And you know, I explained this to a lot of people. I said, look, I consider myself a pretty tough guy. I'm not that emotionally tough, which I came to find out with my one night in jail, but I'm a physically tough guy, and maybe I am emotionally tough. Maybe I just have a lot on my plate. So I told him, I said, I'm not afraid of anyone. And, you know, I consider myself a tough guy, but what I'm afraid of, and I knew this going in, this was my biggest fear, was I'm afraid of myself.
It can be difficult at times because there's really nothing you can do or say to make that go away. And that is why I believe he throws himself into so much and doesn't give himself much downtime. I think he does that purposely to avoid his thoughts in his own mind. You know, I think he's constantly trying to do more and more, you know, so he doesn't have that downtime to think about the reality of, you know, his life at times with the boys.
I'm afraid of being alone with myself, and, you know, because here I'm, you know, in my world, I control my world, and I have the ability to keep myself moving so much that I'm not, you know, slipping into dark places. You know, so as I'm going in, you know, we also had a huge appointment coming up for Troy and Andrew for this clinical trial. So I had to prep them. I had to get Elizabeth prepped and their mother, because initially I was going to take them to the appointment. So that was wearing on me. And then the night before, when I'm getting ready to turn over everything, my cell phones, and, you know, go inside for a month, the anxiety just starts kicking in, and I'm second guessing this, and I just want to run away. It's like a kid, you know, trying to get on that school bus, you know, for his first day of school. You know, I'm internally screaming. I'm like, I can't do this. What did I do? I made the biggest mistake of my life. I can't be away from my family. I can't be away from Troy and Andrew. I get a call from Troy, of course. The van breaks down, and they're stuck. You know, so of course that. Thankfully, Janice took care of it. You know, and she takes care of a lot of stuff for me, and it put my mind at ease. But it really didn't. And then the next day, here we are. It's D-Day. I'm meeting, you know, the sheriff and his deputy out in the middle of the desert with cactus trees, and the cameras, lights, cameras, action. It's rolling. This is it. This is only two people know that you're going undercover. And, you know, they put me up against the cruiser. They pat me down. They cuff me and they stuff me and they bring me into this prison on the Mexican border for processing. I'm now officially Troy Stevens. That's my alias. And I'm saying, what the fuck am I doing? Why did I do this? And I'm trying to convince myself I'm doing it for the kids. I'm doing it for the kids. So I get there. They process me, they strip search me, check my asshole, my ball bag, everything that you would do for, you know, an inmate going in, and make sure I didn't have contraband. You know, you think they could have left that part out, but it had to be, you know, it had to be realistic. And then while I was awaiting a unit or a cell to go into, they stuck me into the hole, into solitary confinement. Now, I was there with one other person, but he was clearly under the influence or coming off the influence of some sort of drug. So he was throwing up and sleeping. And I was in there for 10 hours in probably a 5x5 room. They slid me a bologna sandwich. I'm like, what the fuck am I doing here? This is a nightmare. I'm pacing. I'm talking to myself. I'm saying, this is for Wheelchair Strong. This is for Troy and Andrew. I can do this. I can do this. My head starts talking to me, and I'm going nuts. Like, it's that silence. It's that alone time. It's not having the ability to control things. And I, at that point, I knew I made the biggest mistake in my life. Then all of a sudden they lock us down at 9 o'clock, and these guys go right to sleep, and then I'm up all night. I can't sleep. My mind's pacing. I'm pacing back and forth. Now all along I know I can tap out.
and I can give a code and I can say, get me out of here. You know, it's funny, Troy and Andrew were handling it better than me. They were handling being away from Dad and handling it, but Dad wasn't able to handle being away from them. So it opened my eyes to a lot of different things. It opened my eyes to the fact that a father's fight isn't about doing all these crazy, outrageous things. It's not about getting in the cage at 50 years old and getting my nose broken or getting concussed. It's not about going undercover in prison for 30 days for some sort of stardom. A father's fight is about mentally exercising my brain the best ways that I can in order to be able to cope, A, with this disease, and then be able to take care of these boys. And that means being here. That means going to the dojo 3 times a week and just getting a sweat out and getting the stress out. That means, you know, being in their lives constantly like I've always been. So yeah, I had a lot of epiphanies, you could say. Fighting, I don't need to get in there and fight anymore. I'm fighting here every day. I'm fighting in Carver. I'm fighting with my sons, and I'm fighting with them. During that one night in jail, it changed my life, and it changed the whole direction of this movie.
I think one of the things I've learned during this 2-year journey of filming A Father's Fight is A, I don't, at 50 years old in a few months, I don't need to get back in the cage. It's irresponsible. And I'm certainly not skilled enough to get back in there. It's kind of foolish when it comes to the care of my kids, but this constant training and grappling and being a part of the Lausanne MMA team, it's been great for me. You know, I kind of shed my tears of my kids' disease through sweating. You know, this sweat that comes out of my body, those are the tears that I often hold back when it comes to this disease and what I have to deal with my kids. So as long as I have the ability to continue to do this at my age, I'm gonna keep grappling. Having sore shoulders, a sore back, sore knees. Again, it's nothing compared to what I think the pain my kids feel every day. So, you know, I do it because I love the sport and I love the stress relief, but maybe I also kind of do it because I wanna, in some small way, feel, you know, a little bit of pain like they have to go through every day and endure, so.
I think my best qualities and the reason I was put on this earth and probably sometimes why it's affected relationships is that I think I was put on this earth to be a parent.
When Troy and Andrew and Max are at my house, you know, they bounce between mom's house and dad's house. When they're here, when they're in their bed sleeping, when I'm up at 5 a.m, when Janice, my wife, is sleeping, you know, my daughter's on her own, she's safe, that's when I'm at peace. I usually sit in my hot tub, I put my headsets on, I watch videos, I'll write, I'll reflect, and that's when I'm most at peace, because everyone in my circle I know is safe. Doesn't happen a lot, you know. I don't sleep much at night when the twins aren't with me because I worry that the phone's gonna ring and I'm gonna get bad news, because it's happened before. So I'm constantly on edge, but when they're here, yes, I enjoy my home, I enjoy my deck, I enjoy my hot tub, I enjoy the serenity that I have. For a guy like me that's so crazy, you know, I try to cherish those few moments when I can get them here and there.
You know, was very open and upfront about his lifestyle when we first met and started dating, and meeting the boys, and all of his kids for that matter are just wonderful. He's extremely involved father, and he made that clear from the beginning about the cause and everything he has plans to do.
Janice gets it when it comes to all of this, and she, you know, she knows that at times I dedicate so much to Troy and Andrew. She just said, "Hey, Mark, you know, don't forget that sometimes they need some individual time with each other, so why don't you take Max on a trip down to Florida and go do the amusement parks and, you know, just have some fun one-on-one with him." So yeah, Max and I did have a super great time in Florida, and we're gonna try to make it a yearly thing. And seeing myself in him, you know, he's the closest to me as far as a clone goes, you know, and seeing his artistic side and the creative side that he has, and
You know, and seeing something different that I never got to see with Troy and Andrew because of the disability, so.
It's cool being a big brother to Max. We play video games with him. And he travels to all our soccer games with us, and then we go to his things. So it's pretty cool having a little brother.
I think family has always been a big part of my life, so I'm never like, Dad, I have stuff to do, or I'm never too busy to come over and hang out, just because family is one of the things I value the most, and that's because of how my dad raised us. So
seeing my daughter grow up to be a, you know, this blossom into this beautiful flower and this wonderful, well-rounded girl. And
he's an interesting person, but I love him. He's my biggest fan, and I'm his biggest fan. He's one of my biggest role models.
And I also do, you know, like a monthly dinner with Elizabeth, my daughter, who's my daughter's boyfriend, came to my office last Friday and asked for if he could marry my daughter. He says I had a wall up in the beginning, and I'm. Yeah, probably did, but I got a text from a Phil last week, and it just said, hey, Mark, you want to get together and have lunch? And I thought it was my buddy Phil from the gym, who I haven't seen in a while. And I'm like, absolutely, exclamation point. What looks good for you? And then I'm like, oh, fuck, that's not Phil from the gym. That's my daughter's boyfriend, and I showed way too much enthusiasm in that text back. Now I got to fucking backtrack out of this goddamn thing. So I texted back, and I'm like, oh, I'm sorry, this is Elizabeth's Phil. I said, is everything okay, buddy? He's like, yeah. I go, well, what's up? You want to talk about something? He's like, I just wanted to hang out. I go, dude, I don't hang out with you. There's no fucking hanging out. I go, I'm like Bill Belichick. Just do your job, and that is take care of my daughter. And everything's cool, and I won't kill you. You know? So I'm like, but you need to talk to me about something? He's like, well, I go, look. Why don't you make an appointment at my office? So he came into my office, he had made an appointment, came into my office, and, you know, he was stumbling and bumbling. So I'm like, Phil, you got my fucking blessing. And he's like, woof. And then he shows me a ring. I go, well, that was pretty fucking ballsy showing up with the ring, because if I had said no, I hope you had saved the receipt. That ring was going back. But I like him. And he's a great kid. And you know what the great thing about Phil, in all seriousness? And this is a serious thing when it comes to this movie and it comes to our life, is that Elizabeth's a genetic carrier of Duchenne's muscular dystrophy, so she has to be extra careful when it comes to sex and getting pregnant and all that. And, you know, so she was upfront with Phil from day one when she met him, you know, that she may have, you know, there may be some complications down the road if she wants to have... let's pull over here. No stopping any time, but we'll break the law. If she wants to have, you know, he wants to have a family. So that's something that he had to take into consideration. And Phil's just selfless, and he's just like, look, we'll figure it out. We'll adopt if we have to. I haven't had great success when it comes to relationships, and you know, I would never sit here and point the finger at anyone I've ever been with. You know, my first marriage to Isabel, Troy and Andrew's mom, you know, that just kind of deteriorated for obvious reasons, you know, terminal illness. It just messes you up, and we've had a lot of rocky times over the years, rightfully so, when it comes to the care and treatment of Troy and Andrew, but Isabel welcomes me in her house every day of the week, her and her husband. I'm in and out of their house all the time, nonstop.
Being married to Mark is at times very intense. He's so passionate about the boys and the cause, as well as his profession, his job. He's extremely busy and active, times doesn't ever even sit still.
And one of the things that I told Janice when I met her was, If I wasn't able to give her the attention that any human being needs, then I wouldn't have, I wouldn't have asked her out. Because, you know, everyone deserves and needs certain amounts of attention. So I'm very good at balancing things. So, you know, we get out and we do our stuff just as much as I get out and do my stuff with my children. And then we also do a lot of stuff together as a family, as a whole, as a unit, so.
What? Smile.
Dad, stop being annoying. You're wasting
the battery. I'm not wasting the battery.
Well, we 4 years of high school, we learned on how to code and do all that stuff to build websites. Now, I teach myself. I like to draw. Drawing is fun. Working on the computer, stuff like that. When we come up with the ideas, and we did have an artist that draws them for us, but now we're doing most of the things by ourselves. I like building websites. It's something fun I like to do. And now I know how to, like, I could build a website for, like, if I want to start a company and stuff like that. And we knew we were going to eventually start a t-shirt company. So knowing how to build a website is good, real good.
I think the true success of this film is just to show everyone not only what Duchenne is, but the strong knit relationship families of Duchenne have. We have this strong sense of community because we're all going through essentially the same thing, the same stark circumstances. So I think that showing others around what the initial fight is, along with the awareness, I think that's really important. I also think it's important to show the ability of these kids as well, because yes, they have a disability, but they also have so much more. So I think showing off their abilities as well as the struggle go hand in hand with making awareness.
Mark and his family, while it is stress, I think they take that stress and turn it into a positive with all the work that they've done over the years, with the foundations that they've created, all the money and all the awareness that they've created from this disease. They've taken that stress and that negative aspect of it and really done some really good things with it.
Extremely inspiring. I had no idea until I met them, you know, that 22-year-old boys with their situation could be such amazing, happy, inspiring kids.
So these guys have been performing at a high level. And they have been on a high level for a long time. When steroids came out first, they were one of the first to be on it. When these devices come out, they're among the first to be on it. So they really function quite well. Now, and I think what's driven, they like living.
You know, I'm a detective by trade. I'm an investigator. I research. Maybe that's why I've become a good detective over all these years, because I didn't really look into the facts and I didn't research things back then, and I wasn't, you know, smart enough to do that. And, you know, here I am, almost 50 years old, and, you know, it's been a struggle for 22 years since they've been alive, since they've been diagnosed. And, you know, and I go back and forth and I ask myself, well, geez, but if I did know, and I was a little bit more cautious and more responsible, I guess you can say. But who the fuck's responsible at a young age anyways? But if I was a little more responsible then maybe I could have avoided all this. But then if I avoided all this, I wouldn't have these beautiful kids who drive me and make me smile every day and make me proud. So yeah, it's just a conflict back and forth, you know, in my brain. I would never want them out of my life. I would never want to change the way my life is now.
I totally understand how Mark's dealing with this, and it's the same attitude I have. You never give up, and you push as hard as you can. And I believe diseases are to be conquered, so does he. Diseases are not conquer you. So he pushes every day, and he pushes the kids every day. So he sees the kids battle has been his battle, and that's the way you want it. And look, when you when you lose a battle, when you've done it like that for years, it's going to be harder on people like Mark and the parents. But they really, those are the parents that make a difference.
You know, they amaze me every day with their drive, their energy, you know, their ability to play soccer. They drive over my house every weekend or every other weekend. They're driving over to my house, and I'm sitting on pins and needles waiting for them to come over. And they always show up, and the dogs know when they're coming, and it's crazy. They're great boys, and you know, I'm very, very proud of them.
Troy and Andrew have changed my life in the respect that, you know, some days when you're having a bad day, you know, it's easy to complain about things, and when you look at them and what they face every day, it's just amazing at how they handle life and all the challenges and how they overcome every obstacle that comes their way. Almost makes everything else, you know, every day-to-day problem seem so minor.
Life changes in small ways too, but I think the biggest picture is, you know, how much a kid means to you. And I don't know, that's kind of what everything's about, you know. And you come to Boston and you see the history of this city, and you see the generations, and I mean, that's what life is about, to make things better and pass on any wisdom to your offspring.
Mark's heart, man, endless. You know, he's someone that I went into fight with 12 years ago, and he's someone that I stay in touch with on a consistent basis for no other reason than the fact that I respect this guy. You know, he's got these two kids with the short end of the stick, and it doesn't matter. He's going to fight through everything for them, not even for himself, for them. And just endless heart, man. You know, he's a great dude.
The boys themselves, Troy, they're so impressive. I think anyone that's known him or met them would agree. I think, obviously, someone like myself is way more depressed about the situation than they seem to be. They're great kids. Just to sit around and chat with them for a little while is a blast. And, you know, it's just great, and it's a testament to them and how strong they are, and obviously to their parents, to Mark and everyone involved with them.
Well, I think what Troy and Andrew have more than a lot of people in life is they have a love for life, and they want to go out there and, you know, fight every minute of the day. And you can see this when it comes to par soccer. You can see it setting up their own business. It's really amazing to see. And there's not many people that walk in the door to me that have this, it's just the joy of life and push the boundaries every day. So it's great to see. It's absolutely great to see. Those guys are among the best patients I have.
Being independent is something that they want a lot of disabled people to do. So if you're not stuck at home your whole life, you should be able to live your own life and own your own things.
And I've, you know, I guess when you have to take care of kids from the very beginning, you know, it's a tough balance. When you know that you have kids that have a disease, you tend to act differently. I see parents nowadays that have kids that have new diagnosis of Duchenne's, and I see how they treat their kids, and I try to, you know, counsel them or educate them a little bit on how you're supposed to, you know, handle these kids, because the worst thing you can do is treat them like they're sick. You just gotta treat them like they're a normal kid. They mess up, you ground them, and you discipline them, and you treat them normal, and you can't think about losing them someday. You just got to live every life, every day, you know, with them like it's the last day on earth.
When we were younger, he always had that front, that tough image, you know, but now I see a little bit more of sensitivity in him, a little bit more compassion, and he shows more emotion than he did when we were younger. I think now that we're older, I see that. But I don't think it's changed him. I just think he's grown a little bit more.
So, I mean, I don't know how much I've changed. I don't know, you know, I don't want to be complacent. I can't be complacent, because if I ever grow complacent, then maybe something's going to sneak past me. And if something sneaks past me, then maybe I could possibly be missing something when it comes to my kids.
Happy to have a father like him. Happy to have a father who's always there, that cares. He's a good father to us. Yes, I see myself as a role model to other kids with disabilities. Like some of the kids on our soccer team, they look up to us. It's cool.
We can be in a movie. Yeah. It could help other people too, inspire other people, but like other kids that have our disability, to not give up and just live life to the fullest.
Being a parent means the world to me. You know, growing up, I was pretty mediocre at a lot of things, whether it was sports or whether it was, you know, academics or whether it was just picking up chicks. I was just kind of average. I like to think, you know, as far as being a parent, I'm above average. Being a dad to Elizabeth, Troy, Andrew, Max is probably one of my greatest joys in life, and I think one of the things I'm best at. You know, my kids mean the world to me, and you know, they're a true blessing, and they're, you know, I'd die for them, you know, and I think any parent would, but they're just amazing kids. They make me proud every day, and I like to think that my kids, I just think it's my responsibility and any parent's responsibility to be the best that you can for your kids, because we set an example for our kids. I love being a parent. It's I like being a husband also, Janice, but I love being a parent.
Elizabeth, wait, you're gonna hurt his arm.
Mickey!
Say hi.
Hi.
Say, how are you?
How are you?
Say, poo-poo, caca.
Poo-poo, caca. Want me dance?
Yeah, dance. Dance for daddy.
I can't stand to fly. I'm not that naive. I'm just out to find the better part of me. I'm more than a bird, I'm more than a plane, I'm more than some pretty face beside a train. And it's not easy to be me. I wish that I could cry, fall upon my knees, find a way to lie about a home I'll never see. It may sound absurd, but don't be naive. Even heroes have the right to bleed. I may be disturbed.
Mark will be dancing for $500,000. We're gonna raise some money for Wheelchair Strong, okay? We're gonna raffle his ass off. Look at this, people. Look at that ass. Come on. That is gonna be an ass we're gonna raffle off, okay?
If you want accurate results, then I would just.
Do you know how fucking hard it is for me to go into a sub shop, get a wrap with grilled chicken, and walk away from the chips?
We
can't deal with it. I'm a chipaholic.
I didn't even know what the question was. I made my own question up. Yeah, sorry. What's the question? Oh, the training.
Training.
Yes.
You guys almost 60 years old. He's trying to get back in the cage. Yeah, he's insane. Almost 60 years old trying to get back in the cage. It makes no sense. It baffles all logic.
Cut. I'm not 60 years old.
Well, I think Mark is 40. It's not 49 years old. He is 49 years young. And I think he's fully capable of doing well in mixed martial arts. I think that anybody can achieve anything if they're willing to put their heart into it.
I am doctor.
Yeah.
So re-save the question pretty much.
You just repeat it. If he says, you know, what do you think of Troy and Andrew, you just don't say, they're assholes.
Yeah.
You say, Troy and Andrew are assholes.
Just confirm. Yeah.
Mine? I'm Patrick Renna. Was that one of the questions?
No.
Oh, okay. I was going to say the really easy question.
Oh, there he is. Moving around. Just a smile. It's a moves around the house.
I'm being handed Janice's underwear.
God, the GoPro's recording.
Oh, sorry.
They can hear that when they watch editing.
So, cut for me. I'm done. No more interviews for the rest of this fucking movie.